Good morning, Bethel. Did I hear you say good morning back? Oh, I'm looking at you through your computer right at what? You wear that to bed? Oh, sorry. I can't see you right now, actually. So I know some of you folks are scrambling, going, oh my goodness gracious, turn the computer or the phone away from me. I can't see you. But I really appreciate you showing up this morning to worship with us. This day and age, especially right now with this pandemic, this is a crazy world that we live in. We have a lot of people out and about, as we have people like you, everybody at home worshiping. So the next two Sundays, this Sunday and next Sunday at least, this is the way that we're going to be worshiping. So notice that I said that we're worshiping. Services are not canceled. We are having corporate worship outside these church walls and right there with you in your living room or bedroom or wherever you're at right now this morning. So thank you so much for being here. Let's start off with a word of prayer. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, in a world that right now it seems to be panicking around us, Lord, let us be prudent but not panicked. Lord, let us have faith instead of fear. Lord, let us walk in your ways. Let us seek out your guidance. And Lord Jesus, I pray for healing for those that are sick right now. I pray, God, as whatever is going on in this world, Lord, with this pandemic, God, that you would be the one by your miraculous powers in whatever way that you have, Lord, because you are bigger than even my thoughts right now, Lord. But I pray, Father, that you would get the honor and the glory as this pandemic is reversed, Lord, that healing would take place, and that you, Father, would be the one that, as you have gotten the attention, it seems like, of this world right now, Lord, let them look towards you for strength, for answers, Lord, and I pray that you'll show up and show off in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to worship this morning with Carolyn's going to bring us special music.
Good morning. Matthew 11:28-30 says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Are you looking for someone to be gentle with your broken heart and shattered dreams? Are you searching for someone to be faithful to you no matter what life brings? Well, I know the maker of the storm and sunrise. He is both the lion and the lamb. Yet weak enough to take me as I am, he says, come unto me, all who are weary, and I will give you rest. Bring what hurts, bring your scars, bring the load that you carry. Will give you rest. Are the clouds above your head oh so heavy, bursting with showers of despair? Do you struggle under more than you can carry? Has life given more? Would you like to trade your failures in for victories, like piles of ashes in for piles of gold? Bring the load that you carry, and I will give.
Bibles with me this morning to 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter. 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter. As we continue on our sermon series, the effective prayers of the Bible this morning, how very poignant it is that our prayer this morning comes from 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter, verse 11, and which is the prayer of Asa, which is, help us. In our current times of crisis, we have nowhere else to turn. As a world, we've tried everything else, but right now we're in such turmoil with this coronavirus pandemic. There's only one way for us to turn, and that is turn to God. This morning, we're going to learn from Asa in 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter. You see, Asa, everything was going great for him. He was the golden boy. He was the king of Judah. Everything was going right. He led the country right, and then tragedy hit, exactly like we're going through today. Tragedy. His tragedy was a little different than ours, but when tragedy hits, it is very, very mind-boggling, can be consuming, can be worrisome. And we're going to address that this morning when we read from Scripture. 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter, getting with verse 1, says this, and Abijah rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. And Asa, his son, succeeded him as king. And in his days, the country was at peace for 10 years. Asa did what was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. He removed the foreign altars and high places, smashed the sacred stones, and cut down the Asherah poles. Verse 4. He commanded Judah to seek the Lord, the God of their ancestors, and to obey his laws and the commands. He removed the high places and incense altars in every town in Judah, and the kingdom was at peace under him. Verse 6. He built up the fortified cities of Judah, and since the land was at peace, no one was at war with him during those days, for the Lord gave him rest. Let us build up these towers, he said to Judah, and put walls around them, the towers, the gates, and bars. The land is still ours because we have sought the Lord, our God. We sought him, and he has given us rest on every side. So they built and they prospered. Verse 8, Asa had an army of 300,000 men from Judah, equipped with large shields and with spears, and 280,000 from Benjamin, armed with small shields and with bows. All these were brave fighting men. This was very impressive. It's a very impressive decade for Asa. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. I'm going to attempt this morning to sit down when I preach. You guys know Bethel. Hallelujah. It's kind of like a track meet whenever I preach sometimes, because you guys, a lot of you guys make fun of me because I walk around all the time, but I'm going to try to make it easier for you. I could come and walk around your living room. That might be fascinating. But in the time of us trying to have social separating right now, we probably need to not do that. In Scripture, as I said, Asa He had a very impressive decade. As a matter of fact, he did, it says in verse 2 that he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. He tore down the tools of the pagan worship. He led his people to seek God and obey his commands. He fortified and strengthened the cities. He had done all these good things and had all this good fortune and peace for 10 years. Everything was going fantastic. And then trouble hit. Much like our times today. Seems like our economy was booming. The United States of America was continuing to flourish. And then trouble hit. Let's read in Scripture, the 9th chapter of 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter, 9th verse. Zerah the Cushite marched out against them with an army of thousands upon thousands and 300 chariots and came as far as Mareshah. Asa went out to meet him, and they took up battle positions in the valley of Zephatha near Mareshah. You see, when we read here in Scripture, all was sweet and joyful for Judah until one divisive day. One decisive day when a dark cloud rolled up from Egypt, and his name was Zerah. He rolled up with about 1 million soldiers at his disposal. And he also had 300 mean chariots on top of that. Asa would be the victim of the worst massacre in history. You see, Asa was outnumbered. He was sure to be slaughtered along with all of Judah. They were about to get smashed. It was certain defeat. Ladies and gentlemen, whenever you have certain defeat, what do you do? Whenever there's despair that comes at you from all sides, what do you do? Well, I'm proud to say what Asa does. And we're going to read this. It's what our nation needs to do right now. We need to pray to God. We need to seek out God. Yes, we have people on television from government figures to different pastoral figures to people around the social media talk about pray, pray, pray. And there's a difference in prayer. You see, Asa cries out to God. I believe you and I and people around this world, people of faith, we need to cry out to God. Let's read in Scripture here. One of the most effective prayers recorded in the Bible. You see, Asa did the right thing. He did the thing that you and I need to do in a bleak time. Cry out to God. Verse 11. Then Asa called to the Lord his God and said, Lord, there is no one like you to help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, Lord our God, for we rely upon you. And in your name we have come against the vast army. Lord, you are our God. Do not let mere mortals prevail against you. You see here in Scripture what's going on? Do you read what happened in Scripture there, verse 11? Asa cried out, Lord, help us. Help us, Lord, our God. I think that's a lesson that we need to learn today. Lord, help us. Help us, Lord our God. In our sermon series, we've been going through the prayers that we have been reading over and over again have not been these eloquent, flowing prayers. They haven't been these long, flowery prayers. They haven't had these theological quotes in there and these what I like to call Christianese. That was not been the prayers that we've seen in Scripture that has been answered. But they're just simply prayers from the heart. Asa, he had doom closing in on every side. He was vastly outnumbered. He had nowhere to go except go to God. Do you realize today, ladies and gentlemen, our world has nowhere else to go but go to God? We have doom all the time. All you have to do is turn on the news. And I would hope that you're not watching news all the time because that will get you in trouble. That will take your mind going on a wrong path, a path of worry. Ladies and gentlemen, we are to be concerned. We are to have a healthy, reverent concern about what's going on and understand that God is still in control. None of this is ever new to God. God knows all things. We don't need to have fear, but instead have faith during this time. I want to bring up 3 points here that Asa prays out to God in this prayer in the 11th verse here. Number one, Asa opened up with appropriate words of praise. He says specifically, Lord, there is no one like you to help the powerless against the mighty. I agree with that, don't you? Lord, there is no one like you to help. There is no one like our God. Sure, we could try to replace him with all the things, and look in our world right now. We've tried to replace him, and there's no one like God. Right now, I'm praising God. You know why? Because this pandemic that we have, that this morning I just read was in 148 countries around the world, it's turning people, I believe, back to God. I really do. And people are hopeless. And where does my hope come from? My hope comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. That's where our hope comes from. Asa opened up with appropriate words of praise. He says, Lord, there's no one like you. Next, he stated his petition very, very clearly. And he says here in verse 11, simply help us, Lord our God. Help us, Lord our God. Asa then here, he talks about 4 different reasons why he expected God to answer. First, he says here that Judah was depending on God and not on themselves or anyone else for that matter. Because he says here in Scripture, he says, help us, Lord our God, for we rely on you. Are we relying upon God? Sometimes yes, being honest, sometimes no. Asa had it right when he was saying that Judah, the nation, was very, very clear, said, we rely upon you. That's what you and I can learn from today. Just like Asa reached out to God and said, we rely upon you and ask for this prayer, we as a world, we especially as a Christian people, Christians need to jump outside these church walls and to share the hope of Jesus Christ. The good news, the gospel, the good news, it's the same word. We have the good news. We have the gospel. Let's take that to this hurting world. Asa, in his prayer, he says, help us, Lord our God, for we rely upon you. And then he also says here, he speaks out specifically about how Judah was representing God in this cause. And he says, in your name, we have come against this vast army. In your name. So Asa is saying, in your name, God, we stand up and have come against this vast army. You see, Asa had all of the cards stacked against him. His battleship was literally almost sunk. He cried out to God. He said, Lord, there's no one like you. Help us, Lord our God. We rely upon you, and in your name we come against this enemy. Next, he says this, when he talks about here specifically, Israel belongs to you and is allied to you, our God. When he says this in verse 11, Lord, you are our God. Can you and I make that claim today? Can you, listening to this message right now, make that claim today? Can you say, Lord, you are my God? If you can't, right now is the chance to be able to say that you can. You know how? You simply cry out to God. Simply cry out to God and say, Lord, I ask you to save me. Lord, in these troubling times, I need you to save me. Lord, maybe you may cry out and say this, Lord, if you're real, show me that you're real. I believe that that's awesome. If you really have your mind open to God, he'll show you that he's real. Asa continues on, and he says here, the last part of verse 11, when When he says specifically that the battle is not his, the battle is not the people of Judah's, but the battle instead is the Lord's. When he says this, do not let mere mortals prevail against you. The prayer of Asa in verse 11 again. Asa called to the Lord his God and said, Lord, there is no one like you. Help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, Lord our God. For we rely on you, and in your name we have come against this vast army. Lord, you are our God. Do not let mere mortals prevail against you. God heard Asa's prayer. And what did God do? God does what God does best. He shows up and shows off his miraculous powers. That's what God can do. And I know that in our times it seems like, okay, Lord, do this now. And understand this, ladies and gentlemen, God is not on your timetable. He's on his timetable. Now, we would like to have had this stop right then and there. We would like this pandemic to stop. End of story. That's it right now. God can do that. He has the power to do that. Sometimes God allows us to go through things. We were talking about this for the last several weeks. Because sometimes God allows us to go through things. Why? He's trying to teach us these things. He's trying to catch our attention on these things. Sometimes we're hard-headed. And we need more and more. And then God says, okay, I'll step in and save the day. Now, again, God is God and we're not. Sometimes God heals upon this earth. Sometimes God heals his children in heaven. He's God or not. But understand this. We've been talking about God's conditional and unconditional prayers in this sermon series. God's conditional prayers is where he allows us to pray. And he hears our prayers. And then does what he thinks is best. And in this situation here, ladies and gentlemen, in this scripture, he answers Asa's prayer in a big and powerful, mighty way. Let's read in verse 12. The Lord struck down the Cushites before Asa and Judah. The Cushites fled, and Asa and his army pursued them as far as Gerar. Such a great number of Cushites fell that day that they could not recover. They were crushed before the Lord and his forces. The men of Judah carried off large amounts of plunder. They destroyed all the villages around Gerar, for the terror of the Lord had fallen on them. They looted all the villages, and since there was so much plunder there, they attacked the camps of the herders and carried off droves of sheep and goats and camels. Then they returned to Jerusalem. Did you get that? Did you get that in verse 12 here? You notice that God won the battle for Asa. Did you read that? It says that Asa didn't do anything. You see, that battle was God's to fight. God stepped in a big and mighty way and showed off his miraculous powers. God not only took care of the problems, but he also gave them a large amount of plunder. Can you imagine how excited everybody was? God showed up and showed off and saved the day. God does that. Why? Because Asa prayed. It was not by Asa's own doing. It was not because Judah has their own doing it. Yes, that he was living right and they were living right. And yes, they were doing things right by God. And all these things were going in their favor. And then tragedy still struck. When the tragedy still struck, and then what happened? Asa had to pray. Ladies and gentlemen, our world is in shambles right now. You and I must pray. We must pray. And I believe, exactly like Asa, we pray, Lord, help us. Lord, help us. That is our prayer. You and I can tap into the power of God by crying out for help. In our world today, we desperately need God. As Christians, we need to rise up and replace fear with faith. As Christians, we must stand up and spread hope to a hurting world. Understand this. For God, there is no problem bigger than He is. No problem bigger than God. So as Christians, as people of faith, you and I must stand up and cry out to God, Lord, help us. And in the meantime, when we're going through this, we need to be able to seek opportunities to go out and spread the love of Christ. We need to love our neighbors. That's the command that says all the, are them are wrapped up. All the Old Testament commandments are wrapped up into two. Love your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Next, love your neighbor as yourself. How are you loving your neighbor right now? There's people in need. There's people around you in need. People in this church that has various needs that you need to step up and take care of. Your family members. And it may be something so small. And it may be something large. But God is speaking to us all. And we must do our part. It may be people that are friends of ours or people that are complete strangers of ours. But God needs His people to stand up and show His love to this world right now during this pandemic. So I'm going to ask you to pray. Pray exactly the prayer of Asa here in verse 11. I'm going to ask you to pray that, and I'm going to ask you to show the love of Jesus into this lost world. Join me in prayer. Dear Lord God, Father, Lord, As we have given this opportunity to be able to reach out around the world, Father, and it starts here at home. It starts with us here in Knowles and in Hobbs and in Lovington, how we're able to be able to stand in the gap, Father, and to do something about it. Lord, as we pray exactly the prayer of Asa here, Lord, help us, God. Help us get over this virus, this pandemic. Help us to be able to get past this, Lord. Help us to be able to have our eyes fixated upon You, God, the one that can do all things. Lord, as we're going through this difficult time, let us have our eyes focused upon You, not the fear that we have in this world right now, but our faith is in You, that there's no problem bigger than You are, God. Father, I pray if there's someone listening right now, that if they do not have a relationship with You, that right now, Father, that they would give their life to You and decide to follow You. That they right now would just fall down on their knees, O Lord, and cry out to You. And cry out and say, Lord, I want You to make You the Lord of my life. I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And so, Lord, I repent of my sins and I desire to walk with You all the days of my life. Show me, God. Teach me, Lord. And allow me to grow in my faith. Amen. If you said that prayer, if you prayed, I want you to contact me. You can contact me on Facebook. You can private message me or get a hold of me on the church's Bethel Baptist Knowles Facebook page. My number is on there as well. Call me on the phone. Text me. Private message me. Whatever, because I want to follow up with you. Next, if you need prayer of any kind, I want to reach out to you and reach. Please get in touch with me, and I want to be able to reach out, and that's how I could help you. I could pray with you, listen to you, and I know that this is a deep, dark time in our world right now. That there is hope in our Savior Jesus Christ. I love you, Bethel. Thank you so much for allowing me to be your pastor, and I'll see you next Sunday morning at 11 o'clock at the same time on the same channel. Either on our Facebook, Bethel Baptist Knowles page, or our YouTube channel, Bethel Baptist Knowles. I love you, Bethel. God bless you.